Welcome. This talk presents the message authentication code DAVMAG. My name is Eklist, and this is joint work with Tony Crocho and Ridul Nandi from ISI Kolkata. Message authentication codes take a message M and a secret key shared by the legitimate sender and receiver. The purpose of a MAG is to produce unforgeable tags to guarantee authenticity of the transmitted messages. MAGs can be stateful, randomized, non-spaced, or stateless deterministic. Here, we focus on the latter. For the usual MAG security notion, the adversary has the goal to forge the valid tag for a message it has not authenticated before. For this purpose, the adversary can ask authentication and verification queries. However, it is more convenient to target PUF security instead. An adversary who cannot distinguish valid outputs from random bits has also a hard job to forge. A variety of MAGs is built from classical block ciphers. Many are variants of either the sequential CMAG-like design or the parallelizable design of PMAG. Many of those constructions limit their security to the well-known birthday bound, which suffices in many cases. However, sometimes this is not the case, for example in applications with small size of the primitive. To provide higher security, a single accumulator is not enough, at least not for stateless deterministic MAGs. Instead, a second accumulator is then used for both sequential constructions like 3KF9 or in parallel constructions like in PMAG+. Tweakable block ciphers are a keyed family of permutations that take an additional public input called the tweak. They are useful not only for MAGs. The additional public tweak can be used, for instance, as a domain separator or to process more message material per call. Various existing MAGs already make good use of tweakable block ciphers. At ProfSec 2015, Nitro proposed PMAG TBC1K and TBC3K. The primitive here ensured n-bit security by having different domains for every call. In 2017, Coyetti et al. Proposed in total 4 MAGs, 2 among based on tweakable block ciphers, called Hashes Tweak, here HST, and also Nonsense Tweak, however, our focus is on stateless deterministic constructions. Both used a universal hash function to first compress the message, and then use the second hash of the message, or the nonce, as tweak, and obtain n-bit security also. At Crypto 2017, Iwata et al. Proposed CMAG, also a highly secure and even more efficient construction. Moreover, there are some hashes in authenticated encryption schemes that build on tweakable block ciphers. But let's focus for the moment on CMAG. The innovation of CMAG relied in its internal tweakable block cipher-based hash function called CHASH. CHASH processes the message input in both the state and the tweak in nearly fully parallelized manner. Therefore, CMAG could be more efficient than previous constructions. The state is accumulated in two lanes and at the end is processed in a complex finalization that consists of two sums of two independent permutations each to obtain a final output. One problem for lighter applications of CMAG is that it needs to hold the tweak state, the message state, masks, and the accumulators. This increases the overall number of variables and therefore the size of the state. Sequential MAGs can be made lighter, which may be desirable for some applications. Our motivating question was therefore if we can reduce CMAG to a more sequential construction that does neither sacrifice its high security nor its high rate that CMAG can offer. In our work, we revisited the structure of CMAG and proposed DAVMAG. We arrived at a sequential tweakable block cipher-based design that accumulates the state in two lanes. We could obtain a security of the minimum of n or n plus t half bits. The hash function DAVHASH processes n plus t bit per call to the primitive, similar as CMAG-like designs. Every block is processed in a single call to a tweakable block cipher, where in each block both lanes are used as the input. The t-bit part is added to the top lane as a tweak input. The remaining n bits are XORed to the lower lane's input. The feedforward ensures that the primitive output always affects both lanes. The pad function extends or truncates the n-bit output to t-bit before the next t-bit value is added. At the end, our hash function needs a checksum to ensure high security, which adds all t values of a message. Otherwise, the modification of a single tweak input could produce collisions at the birthday bound. Our construction is an instance of hash as tweak by Coyotti et al., or its generalization hashed in TBC. The finalization uses the n plus t bit output of the hash function and generates a random bit stream. Therefore, it employs the same tweakable block cipher as the hash function under a distinct key. The construction is easily extendable to a variable output PRF by adding a counter to every block and to produce a longer bit stream. Moreover, one could easily derive a single key version by reserving, for example, one more tweak domain bit or by fixing one bit of the tweak input. In the following, we would like to give a brief overview of our proof idea. Our analysis consists of three parts and an easy initial step. First, we replace the primitives with ideal ones. We reduce the construction to the fixed output length PRF security of hashed and TBC. For this purpose, we need two properties of the hash function. First, an upper bound on a collision probability among all messages, and second, a low probability of truncated collisions in X. In the following, we briefly sketch the ideas of those three steps. Prior, we briefly want to recall our notions. By call, we mean the maximal probability of a collision among any two among Q pairwise distinct messages of at most B-bit blocks each and sigma blocks in total. By Tn epsilon truncated almost universality, we mean the probability that two messages collide in their first t bits of their outputs to be at most epsilon. First, we replace the tweakable block ciphers with two independent, random, ideal tweakable block ciphers over the same spaces. Next, we view our construction as an instance of hashed and TBC, so we can apply its security statement. For a single output block, hashed and TBC needs two security properties from the hash function as set. One is a maximal collision probability of epsilon 1 for any pair of disjoint messages. The other one is that the probability that any two among the messages collide in X, which has to be at most epsilon 2. Then, we have a relatively simple statement left. What remains is to show appropriate upper bounds for epsilon 1 and epsilon 2. To upper bound the collision probability, we consider structure graphs. Those represent the message walks where vertices are state values, and edges are transitions from one state value to the subsequent one. Labels are the block values ti, ii. A cycle represents a collision. We define a number of bad walks that will represent the options in a single message to produce a collision. We distinguish between multiple cases depending on the size of the prefix and r, the size of the cycle. In the first case, we consider a structure graph that has a prefix and a cycle of length exactly one edge. In the second case, we consider a walk that has no prefix and again a single edge cycle. A third case has an existing prefix and a cycle of length at least two edges. Finally, we consider a bad structure graph that collides with the beginning. In the first two cases, we have m possible blocks that can lead to a single cycle collision. Therefore, we have m as a factor. In the latter two cases, any two blocks can collide, so we have m choice 2 as a factor. In the former two cases, we have a single n-bit random variable that needs to be hit from an ideal permutation output. Therefore, we have a denominator of 2 to the n minus m since the outputs have not collided before and therefore is sampled randomly from a set of this size at least. In the latter two cases, we have at least two independent random variables. Therefore, the probability for a collision is at most 1 by 2 to the n minus m squared. The sum of all terms yields the following bound among bad walks. We also have to study good walks. Those are walks of two distinct messages that do not collide amid themselves as the bad walks, but instead produce a collision between them. Those messages can have a common prefix. Here, we distinguish four cases by the length of their path from the point where both walks deviate until they meet again. In the first case, we have one message that has a diverging path of length at least three edges. We have another case where one walk has a length of two edges and the other one of at least two edges, and the difference in their tweaks is non-zero afterwards. We have another case which matches the second case in the length of the divergent paths, but has a zero difference in delta t after the diverging path. And we have a case where one of the diverging messages walk has only a single edge until they meet again. In all cases, arbitrary blocks can collide. Therefore, we have m by 2 as a factor everywhere. Moreover, in all cases, we have two independent random variables that must be hit. Since no non-trivial collision has occurred before, they are sampled at random from sets at least 2 to the n minus 2m. Since we have two random variables, we have 2 to the n minus 2m squared in the denominator in all cases. Finally, since t may be smaller than n, we can have a factor in every term. This leads us to the following bounds for a collision in good walks. Summing up, for the collision probability, from bad and good walks we obtain the following upper bound. We conducted a similar study for upper bounding the probability of collisions in only x. Again, we considered good and bad walks. We call walks bad that have a loop in either a single message or a collision in the full x in some blocks between two messages m and m prime. Clearly, non-trivial tweak and input collisions are also collision in x, when non-trivial means that two messages are not simply identical. Since we considered such full-state collisions already before, we can exclude them here and only will give a term for correctness. For both cases of bad walks, arbitrary block indices I and j can collide with each other. Therefore, we have a factor of m choice 2 in both terms. In both cases, we also have a random variable that must be hit, where the new input is sampled at random from a set of at least 2 to the n minus 2m values. Over all messages, this will become sigma again, and we will have the following upper bound for the probability of bad walks. On the other hand, we studied also good walks. Here, two messages collide in x without any bad events. We distinguish between two cases. The difference in the checksum theta is either 0 or not. If it is not equal to 0, then we need a certain output difference from the last primitive call. Since the input was not due to a collision, the probability to hit such a certain output difference is at most 1 by 2 to n minus 2m. In the other case, the difference in the checksum should be 0. Again, for good walks, the inputs of the final primitive call are fresh and the outputs are chosen randomly and independently from a set of size at least 2 to the n minus 2m values. Since we truncate x after the output of the last primitive call, we can have a factor that is larger than 1 if t is smaller than n. We did not have that factor for the bad walks, since there we had considered a collision in the full primitive outputs. Here, we obtain a probability as shown here. Finally, we obtain the following bound for truncated almost universality of our construction. And then, in sum, we can add all terms to obtain the following bound of the PRF security for DAFMEC with ideal primitives. This corresponds to a minimum of n or n plus t half bits of security. We also implemented our scheme. As for the original CMake, it is beneficial to use an efficient tweakable block cipher. Moreover, a long tweak input is good when the tweak schedule is efficient. Deoxys BC or Skinny appeared as natural choices of a primitive. We implemented our construction with Skinny 64128 on two AVR microcontrollers that are widespread, an Atmega 2560 and an Atmega 328P. We chose the existing implementation of Skinny for AVR as a basis and adapted it for our Mac. Since our motivating construction for comparison was CMake, we also implemented the same variant of Skinny in CMake 1, so the variant by Naito in 2018, which replaced the more complex original finalization, also with hashed NTPC. Our goal was to have lower state sizes at the end. We used an existing approach of filling stack and RAM with random values in advance to see how much of them were changed to identify how much RAM was used. While we did not achieve the smallest possible footprint in fully space-optimized implementations, we could reduce the space for the mass and the accumulators. More optimizations are certainly possible, for example, by avoiding functions and only have code without them. We tried that both implementations are comparable. We also obtained a slightly faster implementation for DAFMAC, however, this was not really our goal. Our code is publicly available and can be compared and optimized further. In conclusion, we propose DAFMAC, a sequential variant of CMake with a high rate of n plus t bits per primitive call. It uses both the message and the tweak input to process the message material. We could achieve a high security of the minimum of n and n plus t half bits with our construction without any nonces or random values. DAFMAC could be easily extended to variable output lengths, however, this is not an innovation here. We use two keys, but a single bit fixing or a single tweak bit for domain separation could yield a single key variant. There are certain limitations of our design that we do not want to hide. The checksum at the end is necessary to obtain high security. We propose in our work that it is possible to add the value of the checksum as a final message block. However, we note that this has to be done with caution, since tampering with this value can lead to a security reduction to only the birthday bound. Since our work, we observe that simpler and smaller high-rate schemes have appeared. For example, COCB and COTR by Bao et al., or Romulus by Iwata et al., and AETLR very recently by Gu et al. The NIST lightweight competition has motivated some of them. They also exploit both the message and the tweak input to process much message material in a single primitive call. Their design are actually ways of how to process associated data and not how to encrypt, since they are authenticate encryption schemes. Here we sketch them all in an abstract way how they authenticate only. Their designs are smaller than our proposal, which is actually great. Nevertheless, we stress that they need a nonce. Otherwise, their security is always limited by the birthday bound. Much of the hassle and the higher size of our construction compared to those was needed by the fact that we explicitly targeted a stateless deterministic design, so a nonce and random value free design with beyond birthday bound security. Therefore, we fully acknowledged their efforts and let designers choose the way they wanted. This is so far our proposal, and we thank you for your attention.